With the 50th anniversary of the first moon landings coming up and the prospect of having new lunar explorers, both state-sponsored and private companies, how do you protect what are arguably some of the most important scientific and culturally historic sites in human history? Curious Droid. You would think that the very position of the Apollo landing sites, the Russian lunar cods and the Chinese jade rabbit, would be enough to keep them safe. But there is a similar parallel with the wreck of the Titanic. That sunk in 1912 in 3,800 metres, roughly 12,500 feet of water, its exact position unknown, in what was thought to be an unattainable place. That was until its discovery in 1985, and within just a few years, treasure hunters were recovering artifacts in what many compared to as grave robbing or the plundering of the pyramids. Now, obviously, it's far more difficult to get to the moon than it is to the Titanic, but these days it's not beyond the rich and powerful or other similarly advanced countries. You can imagine what a piece of Apollo 11 would be worth to a rich collector, or finding Buzz Aldrin's boots on eBay, the ones which he had to leave behind to help compensate for the extra 22 kilograms of moon rocks and soil they brought back, not the ones he might use to kick moon hoax believers with. But it's not just the salvage of the parts which might be an issue. Apollo 12 did just that when they achieved a precise landing next to the Surveyor 3 probe and removed its TV camera and other parts and brought them back to Earth for examination. As Apollo 12 found out, just being in the vicinity of a landing site could damage not only the physical objects left behind, but also things like those first footprints and trails left by Armstrong and Aldrin as they traversed the lunar surface. Without weather, wind, rain, or volcanic activity, those footprints could stay there undisturbed for hundreds of thousands or even millions of years, unless, of course, they were hit by a meteor or filled in with dust from a nearby spacecraft landing. Landing on the lunar surface can launch the highly abrasive lunar dust to speeds of several kilometres per second, and with no air resistance to slow it down or much gravity to pull it back to the surface, it can easily travel tens or hundreds of kilometres and effectively sandblast anything it hits. Any robotic rovers, astronauts, or even future space tourists in a historic landing area could inadvertently contaminate or damage the original trails with extra dust or biological elements whilst they move around, and even hovering above the sites could also damage them. Whilst this all might seem a bit far off, consider the Google X Prize, which ran from 2007 and ended unresolved in March 2018. It offered a prize of $20 million for the first private team to land a spacecraft on the moon, travel at least 500 metres and send back high-res pictures or video. That had 10 registered entrants from different countries around the world. They even offered a bonus prize if they could get pictures of an Apollo site, although that was a bit of a contentious issue with NASA. One of the things which scientists are very interested in is seeing how objects which were left behind have fared. Even now, we have very little hard data on how harsh solar radiation, wide swings of temperature, and even micrometeors have affected the man-made objects over the decades since they were left. So, with the possibility of a new wave of lunar explorers, NASA and the US government have issued guidelines for both US, foreign space agencies, and private companies. Now, the landers, rovers, and other equipment left behind are still the property of the governments which place them there, and woe betide any American company that might want to get a piece of any American lunar mission, be that Apollo or previous ones like the Ranger or Surveyor ones. But it's not like there's any guards there to stop anyone from trying, be that in person or by remote control. But the land on which they are currently placed is a different matter. Under the 1967 Outer Space Treaty, or the OST, the moon, the planets, the asteroids and comets are all common land and are not owned by anyone and are effectively open to everyone. This was agreed upon to stop the land grab so often seen here on Earth and the ensuing battles, be that legal or physical, that followed. The problem now is that even if the US attempts to amend or create new treaties that cover the protection of the Apollo sites for the scientific good, others will see it as the beginning of a way in which the US could justify claiming land for itself. And if the US could do it, then the Russians, the Chinese, and even private space companies could try the same. Previous agreements have taken up to 15 years to set up, and if it takes that long again, the chances are that the new lunar visitors will have already been there before they come into place. Also, there is still no real agreement in place for when private companies or foreign space agencies start to prospect and mine the moon, other than to just leave the historic landing sites well alone. But if anything is to go by, it will be the lawyers that will be making as much of a killing as the future miners of the moon. So how do you think we should protect our space heritage on the moon or in space? Let me know in the comments below. And why not check out some of our other videos at the same time. I'd also like to thank you all for watching and all our patrons for their ongoing support. And please don't forget to subscribe, thumbs up, and share.